Hi, let's talk about lymph node groups. Previously, we've discussed the lymphatic system, its distribution, and its function. Now, let's look at the details of how the lymph nodes and vasculature serve your body. As you may remember, the lymphatic system has an asymmetrical distribution of drainage from the body. So we'll find that one half of lymphatic drainage is draining the right upper limb, right thorax, right head and neck, and the other half of lymphatic drainage is draining the remainder of the body. You should also recall that lymph vessels and groups of lymph nodes are going to mirror vasculature. One important thing for you to realize is that it isn't a perfect mirroring of the vasculature, and so superficially you have a lot of the mirroring occurring of the veins, whereas deep within the abdominal pelvic cavity, the mirroring of the vasculature is of the arteries. Lymphatic vessels are going to coalesce into trunks, and those trunks have names that reflect their location. So you may recall that there is a jugular trunk, a subclavian trunk, and then a bronchomediastinal trunk that come together or coalesce to form ducts. Here, we can see the lymphatic duct ascending the thoracic cavity through the root of the neck into the neck, and then it loops around before joining the left venous angle. Metastasis is the spread of disease or malignancy from its primary site or its site of origin to other organs, and there are many different routes by which metastasis may occur. So within the lymphatic system, metastasis occurs when you have the movement of a malignancy from the primary neoplasm, or primary cancer, to secondary sites, and we call these secondary sites METS, short for metastasis. So this is lymphogenous spread, and it is the most typical route for carcinomas or cancers of epithelial and endothelial tissues, so of the skin or glandular epithelium. Malignancy may also spread hematogenously or via the blood, and this is the case for most sarcomas, which are malignancies of connective tissues, and also renal carcinomas. Malignancy may also spread transilomically, meaning along the planes of body cavities, or it may be iatrogenic. So a healthcare provider in the course of administering a transplant of a tissue may take a malignancy unbeknownst to them with other healthy tissue and put it into a donor. Typically, we're talking here about lymphogenous metastasis. That's really the reason why we want to understand the pattern of lymphatic drainage. We talk about nodal involvement. And what this is when the neoplasm or when the metastasis has traveled to and then through a lymph node, and then there is lymphadenopathy and sometimes the remains of that cancer within the node. One of the first places that we'll start with respect to lymph node distribution is going to be the head and the neck. Now, you may have some memory of a family member or a loved one or maybe just a healthcare provider whenever you're ill or just part of routine health maintenance, going about and palpating different parts of your body. And the head and the neck is one of the more common places for such an exam to begin. Your family member might say that they're looking for swollen glands. Well, actually, they're looking for lymphadenopathous lymph nodes, meaning lymph nodes that are slightly swollen or enlarged. Now, lymph nodes of the head and neck are largely associated with veins, and we can see some of them here. So, for instance, along the external jugular vein, we can see some of the superficial cervical lymph nodes. Around the internal jugular, or the IJV, we see some of the deep cervical. And these deep cervical nodes are divided into superior and inferior groups by where they cross the omohyoid muscle. And so most of the lymphatics from the head and the neck are going to travel from this deep cervical superior group to the inferior group and then coalesce in the IJV trunk that then is going to feed into one of the two ducts. And so all of that pattern of drainage is descending the neck into that IJV trunk eventually. So here we can see some of this on a cadaveric specimen. And so here is our omohyoid muscle, one of those infrahyoids. And we can see the carotid sheath descending here. And within that carotid sheath, we're going to have the common carotid artery, for which the sheath is named. We're going to have also the IJV, the internal jugular vein, and associated with the internal jugular vein are going to be these superior and inferior deep cervical nodes as we go. With respect to the pectoral region and the axillary region, so we're talking about the anterior thorax, the chest, and the armpits colloquially, we have a very distinctive pattern of lymphatic drainage. So with respect to potential metastasis of breast cancer, we'll have an origin within the glandular epithelium of the breast that gets picked up by the subareolar plexus here. And there's really two directions that that this material may go. About one quarter of it is going to move to the parasternal nodes and to the ipsilateral breast. And three quarters of it are going to move up into the axillary group. And the first cluster of lymph nodes that get picked up from the subareolar lymphatic plexus into the axillary group are these pectoral nodes. From the pectoral nodes, material is going to move through the central nodes and then through the apical nodes. And then eventually it's going to coalesce into the subclavian trunk on its way to the duct. And so a physician, if they're going to do lymph node biopsies, will start with these pectoral lymph nodes. And if those pectoral lymph nodes are going to test positive for the malignancy, they could then check the central and the apical nodes in order to get a better sense for the progression of the malignancy. Now, deep within the thorax, if you recall, we have the pleural cavity containing the lungs on either side of the mediastinum. And within the lungs, any sort of malignancy is going to be picked up by pulmonary nodes. And so we can see a pulmonary node there, and there, there. And these pulmonary nodes are going to reflect the pulmonary vasculature. Now, the pulmonary nodes are going to push material into what are known as the hilar nodes, also known as the bronchopulmonary nodes. And these are the nodes that are sitting at the hilum of each lung. From those hilar nodes, we move into the tracheobronchial nodes, and we have superior groups of them and inferior groups of them. The inferior groups drain into the superior groups. And from there, lymph and other materials may move superiorly into the bronchomediastinal trunks. And these bronchomediastinal trunks are going to eventually drain into the lymphatic ducts, the right duct at the right venous angle and the thoracic duct at the left venous angle. So this would be the progression of a metastasis that originated within the lungs. So first it would start with the pulmonary nodes, then it would move on to the hilar nodes, then the tracheobronchial nodes, either inferior or superior, then the bronchomediastinal trunks, and then into the ducts. The lymphatics of the limbs are relatively simple, and for both the upper and the lower limb, they're going to follow the pattern of venous drainage. So for the upper, lymph nodes are rather sparse, so we may have some supratrochlear nodes along the medial border around the elbow. These are going to follow the basilic vein up towards the trunk. We have your lateral nodes. These lateral nodes feed into the delta pectoral lymph nodes. Those delta pectoral lymph nodes up in the delta pectoral triangle that's just superior to the pec major muscle is then going to follow the axillary vein into the subclavian vein, and so on and so forth. So eventually, these nodes are going to drain into the subclavian trunk, where then they'll drain into a duct. For the lower limb, it's not much more complicated than that. We still have lymph vessels and nodes following channels. So here's a nice posterior view of the lower limb. And we can see nodes in the popliteal fossa following the popliteal vein, more clustered around the popliteal vein. We also have vasculature that's following the greater and the lesser saphenous veins. The ones that are following the popliteal or the saphenous veins eventually are going to end up in this superficial group of lymph nodes, so around the what you would refer to as the groin. And the superficial inguinal nodes are going to drain into deep inguinal nodes in an area called the femoral triangle. And it's there that they may ascend up into the common iliac nodes of the pelvis. Superficially, across the abdomen and the pelvis, we have a rather useful dividing line. This is known as the trans-umbilical plane. And with respect to lymphatic drainage, anything inferior to that trans-umbilical plane that's marked by the umbilicus there, your belly button, is going down toward those superficial inguinal nodes. And we know that those superficial inguinal nodes drain into the deep inguinal nodes, and then the deep are going to drain into the common iliac of the pelvis. Anything superior to that transumbilical plane will go up into the axillary group and then eventually drain into the subclavian trunk. So eventually anything from the lower limbs will make their way up into these common iliac nodes. The common iliac nodes are then going to drain into the lumbar nodes. The lumbar nodes are sometimes referred to as the lateral aortic nodes. And it's these lateral aortic nodes that are also receiving any lymphatic drainage from the viscera of the abdominopelvic cavity. And these lateral aortic nodes are then feeding into the cisterna chyli. That cisterna chyli is the proximal most portion of the thoracic duct. And so it's a dilated bit of thoracic duct. And from there, lymph is going to ascend through the diaphragm and up through the thorax and eventually drain into the left venous angle and return back into thoracic supply there. So we've discussed the pattern of drainage of several different portions or regions of the body, the head and the neck, the breast and thorax, and the axillary region, the upper limbs, the lower limbs, and deep within the abdominal pelvic cavity. Thank you for your time.